And now a look at the current state of security inside the U.S. As we approach the 15th anniversary of 9/11, journalist Stephen Brill spent the past year looking into how the country has changed since that terrible day, what's been spent, and what gaps still exist. His article, Are We Any Safer?, appears in the latest issue of The Atlantic. And I recently sat down with him and asked him what he learned.
In a nutshell, what I concluded was the way we've responded to the terrorist attacks, to 9/11, which, you know, changed everything, is sort of a microcosm of what we are as a country today. A lot of it was heroic, ingenious, people, you know, going beyond the cause of duty, doing, you know, really great things. And then a lot of it was actually quite the opposite. A lot of beltway boondoggles, billions of dollars wasted because government contractors promised technology and solutions that they couldn't produce. And we've struggled as a country with dealing with the notion of this new kind of risk. The idea, as President Bush explained after 9/11, of never again, we're never going to have a terrorist attack again, that's just unrealistic in today's world.
You clearly give the government, and it spans several administrations, two administrations, credit for getting some things right, as you just said.
A lot of things right, and a lot of unsung people, tens of thousands of people going to work every day at the Department of Homeland Security, the FBI, places like, you know, TSA, the Border Patrol, really obsessed with the job of keeping us safe, and the only time we notice them is when something goes wrong, and that makes it a tough job. On the other hand, a lot of it went back to politics as usual. Every small town you can think of made requests for government grants for Homeland Security, for everything ranging from, you know, routine fire trucks to fish tanks in a police station. So there were a lot of abuses.
I was struck because early on in the piece, you say, yes, we are safer than we were on 9/11, safer against the kind of threat we faced
right
on 9/11, but the threat has changed.
Right.
And that's what the government is, all of us are grappling with right now.
We've done a lot to batten down the hatches, to make us safer at the airports, at the ports, all over the place. But the threats have multiplied, the threats around the world. Our defenses are much stronger. The offense has multiplied and is much stronger. And it's more difficult because unlike the kind of coordinated, orchestrated attack that we faced on 9/11, where people were communicating, money was exchanging hands, that kind of stuff which we could now track, if some lone wolf in his basement is online,
right,
and he can go into a gun store in this country and buy an assault weapon, and he shoots up a shopping mall and, I mean, yells out, you know, something in Arabic, that makes him a terrorist, and that scares us mightily. And that's not something we can really prevent other than doing something about assault weapons.
So how, I mean, that's what interested me so much in this piece, was you look at the one thing after another that the government did, some of it successfully, but still you have this undefined threat out there, some of which, as you say, it's a lone wolf, it's somebody who may be just mentally unstable
and
who decides
some,
to adopt
right,
the terrorism.
Exactly,
ban.
And there are some non-lone wolf threats, some kind of more orchestrated threats that were in the headlines right after 9/11 that basically fell out of the headlines and therefore fell off our radar, and frankly that the government hasn't paid enough attention to. The best example is a bioterror attack. You know, right after 9/11 with the anthrax attacks, that's all we thought of. The technology that we tried to develop 15 years ago still hasn't been developed that would warn us in the right way of a bio attack. We've done not enough to protect ourselves from dirty bombs. You can still go to hospitals and other industrial sites all over this country and maybe have to break a tiny little padlock, if that, to get a hold of radiological material that you could mix with an easily available explosive and create a dirty bomb.
But why hasn't something like that been addressed?
Because we tend to go after yesterday's headline, our attention shifts, and we don't, you know, when you say that everything's a priority, if you have 10 or 12 high priorities, none of them becomes a priority except if it's in the news, if it's in the headlines, if it's part of a congressional hearing, maybe. So we haven't done the job we need to do of really assessing all the threats rationally and having a discussion with the American people that says we can't deal with everything. We have to have priorities. And some things are going to slip through the cracks. And by the way, there are going to be terrorist attacks, not of the kind we had on 9/11. People are never going to be able to hijack a plane because of the TSA, because we've fortified cockpit doors in airliners. We've done a lot of things to deal with that, but we haven't done much to deal with trains or ferry boats, for example.
Because of our political system, as you say, it is hard for our leaders, to say candidly to the American people that there will always be a threat out there, that you cannot completely...
President Obama has tried to do that, and every time he's, even in a subtle way, tried to do that, where he's said, and indeed his Department of Homeland Security has implemented, really important mitigation measures, really important, you know, recovery measures if there's an attack. There was a drill in Boston just a few months before the bombing there. And when they did a report about that drill and how that had really helped to save lives after the Marathon bombing, he was attacked by Senator Coburn for putting too much emphasis on mitigation and not enough on prevention. Now, that to me is the equivalent of saying, you know, why do you have ambulances on call? Why don't you do something about crime and traffic safety? Well, you try to prevent crime and you try to prevent car accidents, but you have emergency rooms, you have ambulances, you acknowledge the fact that you're not going to prevent all traffic accidents. We are not going to prevent all terrorism, especially if you define it as someone being able to get an assault weapon, which you can do in this country, and claim to be loyal to ISIS or some organization like that.
What would you say to the next leader of this country, the next president, about what most needs to be done to make this country?
Well, the first thing that needs not to be done is to declare war on Muslims or Islam, because that's exactly what those terrorists want. They want this to be the apocalyptic end of all worlds war between them and us. And President Bush didn't take the bait, and President Obama has resisted taking that bait. Donald Trump campaigns on that. It almost makes you think, in fact, it makes me think, that ISIS would love to have someone like Trump be president because they get the fulfillment of their dream, which is to have the great confrontation with Western civilization. The second thing is to keep educating the country while doing everything you can to prevent terrorism, keep educating the country to the reality that there are going to be some attacks, and that doesn't mean it's the apocalypse. It doesn't mean we're weak. Saying there are going to be attacks doesn't mean we're throwing in the towel, but it means we have to be realistic.
Well, it's certainly a provocative piece. It's one that reminds us of how complex the challenges are, and they don't get any simpler as time goes by.
Thanks.
Stephen Brill, are we any safer than we were on 9/11? Thank you very much.
You're welcome.